Hello everyone, this is Roger from Wave Computation Technologies. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate how to use the software Wavenology to design a monopole antenna. So before I start it, I strongly recommend that you take a look at the WCT's video tutorial about dipole antenna, which is available in our website right over here. And then from now on, I will assume that you've watched the video and you know everything about dipole antenna already, okay? So eventually, we're going to design some model like this. This is how the monopole antenna looks like, with a ground and the pin metal rod that is exposed to the air and it's radiating, and with the feed lines, coaxial cable feed lines right over here, okay? So if you Google about the monopole antenna, you can also take a look at the real structures. Like Google here, monopole antenna, you have a lot of images shown up here. Then you can take a look at the real structures. Okay, something like here with a metal board and then rod. Even it can change the shape, something like that. Okay, so that's how it looks like in the real physical models. In our software, we can also model the 3D structures as well. So let's take a look at the topic that is going to be covered in this tutorial. First of all, I want to introduce image theory in electromagnetic problems, and then the relationship between monopole and dipole antennas. And then I'm going to use a software to design a model and validate the theoretical predictions that we learned from the first two items using the software Wavenology. And last, we can play around with our designs and start to consider some practical issues in our real designs, okay? So let's take a look at the first one, image theory. In a textbook, it's always talk about simple problems, like in this case, for image theory to be applicable, it has to assume a half-space problem. So it would be something like half-space, infinite space will be air, free space, and then the other half will be perfect electric conductor, called PEC. So if the problem background is like this, and then I have a electric current, which is represented by the red arrow, flowing from the bottom to top, upward, then if I want to calculate the total field at a certain point, for example over here, it just looks like as if there's another image down here inside a PEC with the same height, okay, opposite position right over here, radiating together. So if I want to calculate a field over at this point, I just calculate the field radiated by this one over here to from here to here, then calculate the field radiated from this image from here to here. Add them together, I will be able to get my total field accurately, analytically. So that's all about image theory, okay? But there are several situations. First of all, if the electric current is perpendicular to the PEC, the image will be something like this, okay? Same direction, upward. If it's parallel, then the direction is opposite. However, for a magnetic current, it's more understandable. It's more close to the real physical mirror. Like you take a look at the mirror. The direction will be similar to that. That means perpendicular will have opposite direction, and if it's parallel, it's the same direction. Okay, so that's all about this image theory about the PEC case. In the other situation, when the half space is called perfect magnetic conductor PMC, the story is going to be changed a little, but it's still very symmetric to the other case. This is called a duality. So that means if I have an electric current flowing upward, then my image will be at the opposite direction. Then in the parallel case, it'll be the same direction. However, in this case, for the magnetic current, mirror to a PMC will be the same direction for a perpendicular case and opposite direction for the parallel case. Okay, so that's all about image theory. Then let's think about why this is important before we go into the relationship between monopole and dipole antennas. So let's take a look at some designs over here. Now this is a dipole antenna with one rod on the upper part and then the other rod on the downward side. Then let's take a look at the monopole design. I have ground, PEC, and I have a rod, only one rod, okay, on above the PEC. So let's go back to this image. Well, can we imagine something similar, like we have a PEC ground, I have a rod from the interface to a certain length, okay, and I have a current flowing through the rod. Then according to the image theory, I will have a similar rod, like an image, which with the same current flow direction radiating as well. So if that's the case, then we can connect dipole and monopole antenna together. We can assume, we can guess that monopole is radiating very similar field as dipole antenna according to the image theory. Okay? Then when we design the monopole antenna, we can apply all the design principles for dipole antenna just with half rod considered. Okay? So then let's validate if our imagination, our prediction is correct. So let me design this monopole antenna in our software Wavenology. So eventually it will be something similar to this. Then I just start from the very beginning and consider everything from the first step. So for example, this is a new project, empty project. And then let's first consider the design part, unit. I'll leave everything to be default. Then background is air. Then the boundary, in this case, I know a lot of. I'll just choose open without gap. That means it will right, the boundary will right touching your geometry bounding box. Okay. So in the X direction, Y direction, I choose the same. In the minimum Z direction, I choose the same as well. But for the top, Z plus, I'll choose open with the gap. Okay. So I apply that. Then the frequency, I'll just choose 1 gigahertz to 18 gigahertz. High enough. The mesh, I typically like to choose 20, but 10 is sufficient already. Then everything else, I leave it as default. So I finished the design part, okay, very quickly. Then I need to draw my geometry, the monopole antenna. So I will use the cylinder geometry part. So I choose the material to be PEC, which is representing, okay, metal or something, okay. Then the height, I want it to be 42 millimeters, okay. And then I want it to be a pure cylinder, so the inner radius, I choose to be zero. And this one, I want it to be 0.635 millimeters. Okay, and I click OK. You will see, okay, I have a rod ready. Okay, right over here. Then I need to draw another geometry, which is the coaxial cable that is feeding this monopole. So I'll use the same structure over here, PEC. Now in this case, I wanted the height to be 20 centimeters only. And I want it to be completely wrapping this rod. So I'll choose the inner radius to be 0.635. And then the outer radius, I want it to be 2.1 millimeters. So I click OK. It's asking the intersect region. I just choose none. So okay, I have a geometry over here wrapping it. Okay, then I noticed that you can also re-edit the geometry as you wish. Okay, you can take a look at all the parameters. And this one, the material is actually wrong. It should be Teflon. So I just create a new material. And I just name it as, you know, material and whatever it is. Then change the color to it. And then I want it to be 2.1. Then I add a little bit loss to it. Very, very tiny loss to it. And that would be some material like Teflon. And then you see, okay, I have a coaxial cable ready for it. Okay. Now I need a PEC wrapping around this dielectric. So I need to create another cylinder. I choose it to be PEC again. Height, I want it to be 20 millimeters. Now the inner radius will be 2.1. And the outer, I want it to be 3.1. Click, and then you will see, okay, I have a coax cable feeding over here from the bottom. And then I have the center rod exposing to the outside. Okay. So that's almost ready. Then we need to create a PEC thin plate to representing the ground. Okay. So in this case, I'll just choose to draw a box. I choose material to be PEC. Then the size, I want it to be minus 10. And then start it from 18 millimeters. The other corner will be 20. Okay. So if I click that, it's asking you, okay, it has an intersect region together with the PEC, with the rod. In this case, I'll just choose what kind of materials you need to use for the intersector objects. So I use the existing objects for the following clash cases. I click OK. You will be able to see, okay, I have a ground. All right? And the inner part is also still using the Teflon material. Okay. So that's all. That's all about this geometry creation. Very, very simple. And one thing I need to mention is, because in the boundary part, I choose the option open without gap. That means the boundary is right touching the object bounding box, as you can see here. So in the WIMnology, if you specify as this case, especially when PEC is touching this boundary, that means it's extruding infinitely. It's representing an infinite large ground because the PEC is touching the boundary. Okay. If you leave a gap, that means you have air between. Then this PEC ground is finite size. Okay, so that's how you design the first case. Let's consider the infinite ground. So I use it to touch the boundary. Next, you need to put a source in order to start a simulation. In this case, I will use a waveport source to excite the coaxial cable. So in the three items here, you simply right-click over here, create a waveport, and then a dialog will come up. Okay, and then I want it to be at the Z min direction, so I enter my position to 2.1 minus 2.1 to 2.1. The reason I pick up 2.1 is, remember, the radius of the dielectric is the 2.1. So I want to completely cover this region in order to feed in the field. Okay. Everything else, you leave it as default and click OK. So now you see a waveport is right here, covering all the dielectric area. Okay. So I have a waveport ready. So basically, that's it. The simulation is ready. It's ready to run. So you just save the project and click the run, and then you're able to check some result. Okay, so I've already pre-run some simulations already. So in this case, it's identical to the design I just did. I define a lot of things to be observed. So first, let's take a look at the S parameters. Turn this field, then I load my S parameters. Okay, so, all right, I have the rod length exposed to the outside has a length of 22 millimeters, if you recall that, right? So, let's take a look at the first resonant frequency according to the S parameters. So, it's around 3.1 or 3.2 gigahertz, okay? And then the second resonant frequency is around 9.2 7 gigahertz. Okay. Then the third one is right around the 16.2 gigahertz. Okay. How can we explain this? So typically, if you consider the length of the rod is 22 millimeters, and then it's quarter wavelength, then you're able to calculate the frequency, the first resonant mode. So let's see if the speed of light in free space is 3e to the 8 meters per second. And if quarter wavelength is 22 millimeters, then the entire wavelength is 4 times. So that's 88 millimeters. So this is dividing 0.088. This is representing in meters. So that will give you the first resonant frequency, about 3.4 gigahertz. Okay, we're a little bit off, but I'll explain why we have the frequency shifting. Okay, then the second mode will be 1.5 standing waves within this length. Okay, so that means we will have 3 quarter wavelength resonating. Okay, so that's actually 3 times. So if you multiply this by 3 times, that will give you some like around 10 gigahertz something. And again, we're still a little bit off because of the real physical model. And then the keep going, you can calculate the next resonant mode. Okay, so this is how it looks like in the S parameters, the resonant frequency. So the thing I want to show you between monopole and dipole is the current distribution. Let's take a look at the first resonant frequency, 3.17 gigahertz. So if you take a look at the current distribution on this monopole, you will see it's a quarter wavelength. Okay. If I open the dipole, this is the first resonant frequency of the dipole. Let me turn over to the other side. So you can observe the dipole first resonant frequency. There's one standing wave along the entire dipole. Okay, but for the monopole on the first resonant frequency, you only see the half. Okay, so that means a quarter wavelength. And the coaxial cable feeding inside, it's a different story. So you only consider the part above the PC ground. If we take a look at the second resonant mode, in this case, I chose to do it this way, and you will observe, okay, I have 1.5 standing wave on the monopole. Then if I compare this with the dipole in the second resonant frequency, you will see I have 1, 2, 3 standing waves. And then if I cut it by a half, you will see 1.5, okay? Now, if I keep going to the third resonant mode, you will see 1, 2.5 standing waves, okay? Then recall to the dipole on the third frequency, you'll see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So on the half, it will be 2.5. Okay, so that's how I predicted the image theory about the between monopole antenna and dipole antenna. It's basically the resonant frequency. It's how you calculate it. Okay. So next, let's consider the far field, the radiation. In reality, you don't have a infinite size of the PEC ground, so you have to use a finite size of the plate. But that will introduce a lot of disturbance. Okay, so for example, if I in my design, I leave the boundary to be open with the gap on the x and y directions, then you will see, okay, there's a gap, okay, and this plate will be finite size represented. So if you simulate that, you will be able to see the far field is actually quite disturbed. First of all, the resonant frequency is disturbed. If you take a look at the S parameters, it's still about the same, but the first resonant frequency is actually changed a lot. It's almost 3.6 GHz. This is due to the finite size of the plate. It has a capacitance, okay? And then the entire structure has its own resonant frequency, so that will generate some disturbance, okay? So if you take a look at the far field at the first resonant frequency, it's actually not matching what we really want. The total energy radiated is completely downward, okay, because of the finite size of the plate. So that might not be your what you want, but in the second mode, you will see, okay, this is much better. Things are reflected, because in the high frequency, the plate looks much larger in the eyes of electromagnetic waves. Then it's reflected, radiation pattern is more close to the large PEC plate, okay. Then on the third resonant mode, okay, so it's more directed, more energy reflected by the PEC plate, okay. So this plate size really played a very important role in the radiation pattern and the resonant frequency. So in order to study this, we can use the software to do a parametric analysis. So you can sweeping the plate size by different size. In this case, I just use a small plate and then sweep the plate size to be very, very large. Then I can take a look at the resonant frequency, how they are going to change. So I did 5 simulations with smaller to larger PEC plate, okay? And the monopole remains the same, and the coaxial cable excitation all remains the same. Only the parameter change is the plate size. Then let's take a look at the resonant frequency according to the S11 parameters. As you can see, for the second and the third resonant mode, because the frequency is high, it's not being disturbed a lot. Okay. So it's almost still at 9.7 GHz around. But for the very low frequency, the first resonant mode, it did impact a lot. So you have some disturbance. Well, the frequency change is that kind of complicated. Because in certain size, you might excite the resonant mode of the plate. Okay, that will generate a different radiation pattern. But if you make it larger and larger, you will see the frequency is converging to the ideal infinite size PEC plate. Okay, so that's how you explain what is the PEC plate size impact your real designs. So in this case, let's take a look at the radiation. If I make the PEC plate is very, very large already, then on the first resonant mode, 3.2 GHz, I display, as you can see, energy is bouncing back to the upward, okay? But again, it's not like a round shape. It do have some strong points and some weak points. And the reason for that is because the corner. Okay, you don't have a symmetric, cylindrically symmetric shape. That's why it generates some radiation pattern. It's not going to be quite round as well. This can be explained through the snapshot of the transient field. Okay, so I take a field cut over here with the monopole above and the PEC ground. If I use the log view, as you can see, the field is coming out. At the beginning, it's actually round, but after it hit the corner, now you begin to see there's it's not round anymore. It has 4 corners. Okay, so this is how you use a large plate, but if you have a sharp corner, it will impact your radiation far field as well. Now to fix that problem, in this case, I'll just use a round plate. Okay. As I show in the beginning pictures. And then the monopole keep the same. I just use a large round plate. Then I calculate the radiation far field at the same frequency. Then you will see, okay, now it's much better. Okay, it's a round shape, and the energy is reflected back for the first resonant frequency. Okay, then if you take a look at the transient field. Still use log size. Okay, as you can see, the field is coming out. But now, because it's round, and the field, the surface current is always symmetric. Okay, so this is how it's radiating out. So this is how you consider the monopole antenna with some real case. So we've covered, okay, in the design principle, we use image theory to analyze the monopole antenna. And we borrow the principles for dipole antenna design. And it's similar and can be applied to monopole antenna to determine its resonant frequency as well. Then we use the software design that, and then we validate this principle. But we do see there's a little bit difference. The real simulation is not matching the theory perfectly. But there's a reason for that. One, number one is because the rod has a thickness, which create additional capacitance to make the wire looks longer. Okay, that draw make your frequency goes lower a little bit compared to the theory. And then some practical issues is the PEC ground, because you normally don't have an infinite size. The PEC size, the PEC plate size and its shape has also impact on the radiation on the far field as well. So that's how you use the software to validate your theory, to learn the design, and to consider some real practical issues during your design. Okay, so that's all about this tutorial, and I hope you like it. Thank you for being my audience.